Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to this press conference of the Caricom Reparations Commission being held here at the headquarters of the University of the West Indies. We are, of course, met this morning in celebration of the spirit of our Nelson Mandela, whose views and visions and virtues we hope will work towards the framing of this century as a place for peace and reconciliation for all of humanity. I believe it would be appropriate for us at this moment just to reach out to all peoples around the world in a minute of silence in recognition of Mr. Mandela's contribution and his spirit upon this earth. Thank you. Thank you. It is now my pleasure and my honor to introduce to you members of the head table. It is a pleasure to introduce Minister Lisa Hanna, Minister of Youth and Culture of Jamaica. Minister. Professor Vereen Shepherd, who is Deputy Chair of the Caricom Commission for Research. Mr. Armand Zunder, who is Deputy Chair of the Commission for National Commissions. Lord Anthony Gifford, who is a stalwart and a veteran in this struggle for reparatory justice, legal luminary who has joined us this morning. Mr. Richard Stein, who is a lead attorney with Lee Day, the British law firm that has been asked by CARICOM to carry out preparatory legal advice. Mr. Bert Samuels, who is a legal luminary in the Caribbean and who will be assisting us in our thinking on this matter. And Hillary Brown, who is with CARICOM and is CARICOM organizer of our affairs. I'm going to begin by inviting Minister Hanna to say a few words.
Thank you, Professor Beckles. Let me first of all add my own commendation and recognition to those of persons at the head table, in particular Professor Vereen Shepherd, who is the chairman of our National Commission on Reparations, and she's joined by several members of the commission who are here this morning, some at the head table, Mr. Bert Samuels and Lord Gifford, Dr. Hillary Brown from CARICOM, our visiting guest from Suriname, and certainly Richard, welcome to warm Jamaica. I know you must be very happy to be here. And of course, Professor Hillary Beckles, who most of you are aware, along with Professor Vereen, have been doing seminal work in the cause for reparations. We really meet at a time when the world has converged to recognize and pronounce that truth and reconciliation is necessary for progress and for trust in building the world going forward and in terms of fostering unity And I want to echo what Professor Beckles has said in the spirit of Mandela, because we meet at a time, certainly in this arena, where we have come to say that this particular cause of reparations is integral if we are to recognize as a people, both regionally within our respective countries, that there are vestiges of slavery that have certainly slowed our progress as a people and certainly as separate countries and as a region on the whole. I want to say from our part right here in Jamaica, our National Commission, and I know Suriname and I know other countries, Barbados, have been doing really good work in terms of looking at the arguments and grounding the arguments. You have our support, certainly from us nationally here, and you certainly have the government support of Jamaica. Coming out of the conference in July recently, where Caricom decided that it was now time to have a regional commission for reparations, we are clear that our work must feed into that and bolster those activities. The report in Jamaica is complete, and the submission has been prepared for it to go to Cabinet so that it may be laid on the table of the Houses of Parliament for debate. We will continue our work right here, and I want to just also add that we're not only the Ministry of Youth and Culture, Professor Beckles, but we represent the majority of children who are here in Jamaica, and we represent young people who are looking for a cause to fight for. And I believe that if we give the correct information about the history, the correct information about what their ancestors went through, I think we have a unique opportunity to mobilize the momentum to go forward with this cause. And so I just want to make sure that our deliberations, both locally and regionally and internationally, give our young people the voice as well to express themselves. So I want to congratulate you for using Jamaica, and also to thank the University of the West Indies, because they've been very hospitable to us in terms of the local commission, and to also propose that your next meeting can be held right here and we would facilitate that meeting of the regional heads. So thank you all.
Thank you so much, Minister. I should say that Minister Hannah's spirit has been a great guide to all of us, and the elegance and the eloquence of her mind is an asset and will be a guide to all of us in this movement going forward. And Minister, on behalf of the Commission, we thank you so much for what you have done and what you will continue to do in the future to guide us. The process this morning is that I will read this statement, which represents the views of the Commission. This statement will be circulated to all of you. Thereafter, we will open the conference to any questions or comments which you wish to make. And I wish to say to all of you that we are being streamed live on the internet, and therefore you must should bear that in mind. The 34th meeting of the Conference of Heads of Government, which was held in July 2013 in Trinidad and Tobago, agreed to set up national committees on reparations to establish the moral, ethical, and legal case for the payment of reparations by the former colonial European countries to the nations and peoples of the Caribbean community for native genocide, the transatlantic slave trade, and a racialized system of chattel slavery. Heads of government further agreed to establish a CARICOM Reparations Commission comprising the chairs of the national committees and a representative of the University of the West Indies, which would report directly to a prime ministerial subcommittee on reparations chaired by the Prime Minister of Barbados, the Honorable Frondell Stewart. To date, national reparation committees have been established in 8 member states, namely Antigua and Barbuda, Barbados, Belize, Guyana, Jamaica, St. Lucia, St. Vincent and the Grenadines, and Suriname. The executive of the Caricom Reparations Commission met on December 9, 2013 in Jamaica at the regional headquarters of the University of the West Indies in order to define and set in train its plan of action. It did so within the context of the global celebration of the life of Nelson Mandela, who by his sacrifice and teachings provided the world with a moral and ethical framework within which the diplomatic and political search for truth, justice, and reconciliation can be attained. The Commission affirmed its commitment to the principles inherent in the living legacy of Mr. Mandela. The Commission affirmed the argument that Caribbean societies have been built upon transatlantic slave trading and chattel slavery, which have been declared by the United Nations as crimes against humanity. These societies are uniquely placed to advance the global cause of truth, justice, and reconciliation within the context of reparatory justice for the victims of their descendants who continue to suffer harm as a consequence of these crimes. The Commission called upon the former slave-owning nations of Europe, principally Britain, France, Spain, Portugal, the Netherlands, Norway, Sweden, and Denmark to engage Caribbean governments in reparatory dialogue to address the living legacies of these crimes. The Commission noted that Caribbean societies also experienced the genocide of the native population, which was also declared a crime against humanity by the United Nations. The victims of these crimes and their descendants were left in a state of social, psychological, economic, and cultural deprivation and disenfranchisement that has ensured their continuing suffering and debilitation today, and from which only reparatory action can alleviate their suffering. The Commission stated its intention to call upon CARICOM heads of government to seek reparatory dialogue with the former slave-owning states of Europe, which were enriched by these crimes, with a view to seeking the support for the eradication of the legacy that serves to subvert the development efforts of national societies. The Commission endorsed the views expressed by the CARICOM heads of government that this dialogue be conducted in a diplomatic, conciliatory, and morally uplifting fashion consistent with the reparatory search for social justice and human decency. The Commission recognized that Caribbean youth are among those most disenfranchised and denigrated by the colonial legacy that has racially profiled and oppressed them as descendants of the enslaved, and who have a human right to live in an environment that is supportive of their willingness to contribute positively to humanity. The Commission calls upon Caribbean youth to participate in reparatory consultations aimed at uprooting these legacies that define, oppress, and limit their ability to be positive global citizens. The Commission affirms the principle of the Durban Declaration and Program of Action that calls for the acknowledgement by former slave-owning nations that slavery and slave trading were crimes against humanity, and calls upon these nations to issue statements of formal apology and commit to a reparatory process that includes, among other actions, the facilitation of the repatriation program. The Commission identified and discussed six broad aspects of the Caribbean condition that are the direct result of these crimes that should be the focus of a reparatory diplomatic action. These are public health. The African descended population in the Caribbean today has the highest incidence in the world of chronic diseases in the forms of hypertension and type 2 diabetes that are the direct result of the nutritional exposure, endemic and inhumane physical and emotional brutalization, and other aspects of the stress experience of slavery and post-slavery apartheid. Scientific research and cost associated with stemming this historically derived pandemic must be addressed. Education. At the end of the colonial period, the British left the African descended population and survivors of the native genocide in a state of general illiteracy. Some 70% of these persons were functionally illiterate at the onset of the independence era. Widespread illiteracy continues to plague Caribbean societies and accounts for significant parts of their developmental challenges. Cultural institutions. Europeans have invested in the development of institutions such as museums and research centers in order to prepare their citizens for an understanding of their imperial history that defined them as rulers and beneficiaries of slavery. There are no such facilities in the Caribbean where these crimes were committed and the victims left disenfranchised in respect of their institutional and cultural experiences and memory. This crisis must be remedied. Cultural deprivation. The primary cultural effect of slavery was to break and eradicate African commitment to their culture. African culture was criminalized and the cultural basis of identity shattered. Africans were deculturized and today remain impoverished in respect of cultural legitimacy and supportive appropriate institutional arrangements. These matters represent the colonial legacy of slavery and must be addressed. Contemporary manifestations of these include lower ethnic self-esteem, the devaluation of black identity, broken structures and diminished family values, delegitimization of African-derived religions and cultural practices, and the disconnection from ancestral roots and culture. Psychological trauma. For over 400 years, Africans were classified in law as non-human, chattel, property, and real estate. They were denied recognition as members of the human family by laws and practices derived from the parliaments and the policies of Europe. This history has inflicted massive psychological damage upon African descendants and is evident today in social life. Only a reparatory dialogue can begin the process of healing and repair. Psychological and scientific and technological backwardness. For over 400 years, the policy of Britain and Europe had been that the Caribbean should not participate in any manufacturing or industrial process and should be confined to the production of raw materials. This policy has rendered the Caribbean a technologically and scientifically ill-equipped civilization for which it continues to experience debilitating backwardness in a science and technology globalized world. The subjection of the Caribbean to this state has denied Caribbean youth membership and access to an enhancing scientific and technological culture that has become the world's youth patrimony. This matter must be addressed in reparatory dialogue. The Commission engaged in 2 hours of consultation with British attorneys from Lide, an internationally respected law firm that specializes in cases of this nature, in respect of the legal framework within which such dialogue should and can take place, and was satisfied with the soundness of their brief and recommendations. The Commission agreed that the services of Lide were valuable, and when articulated with those of Caribbean legal luminaries, should constitute the advisory legal team necessary to frame recommendations to the heads of governments. The Commission reaffirmed the argument that Caricom should request reparatory dialogue with beneficiary slave-owning European states with a view to formulating a new development agenda for the Caribbean, taking these reparatory objectives into consideration in order to promote the 21st century as a period of mutual respect, recognition, and conciliation. The executive agrees that there shall be a meeting of the full commission towards the end of January 2014 in order to further develop these positions and to provide the Caribbean and the wider world with an opportunity to discuss and deliberate upon the evidence that speaks to reparatory justice within the Caribbean context. The Commission agreed that its first interim report should be ready for submission to the CARICOM Heads of Governments meeting in mid-February 2014. I thank you very much for your generosity of listening to this press statement. It is now my pleasure and honor to open the conference to any question or comment you may have. If you would please address your question or comment to the chair, I will then be in a position to direct your comment to the relevant member of this panel. I thank you.
Hi, morning. Jaleen Pearson from RFM. My question would be directed to you. The British He was here. A member of the British diplomat was here, and he said that he didn't believe Britain was in a position to offer such, you know, to agree to your terms. What is the committee's feeling on that generally?
Well, we are in the process of opening a dialogue. It is for the heads of governments to decide at what time and in what manner they will engage the governments of Europe on this matter. So we are really, in a sense, preparing a report after the relevant consultations, which we will submit to the heads. The heads will then make that determination how they will respond and how they will engage any government.
Right, this is the same timeline as 2014?
We are hoping to submit our first interim report to the heads at that time.
All right, thank you.
Dave McFadden from Associated Press. I seem to remember that the law firm had said that there were going to be three governments engaged. It sounds like there's potentially quite a few more. Do you know how many governments will be potentially engaged or asked to make reparations at this stage? Before, I thought it was Britain, France, and the Netherlands, just those three.
Well, as we stated here in the press statement, we are recommending that the engagement takes place in respect of all of the European slave-owning nations. At the moment, the principal six nations have been identified. Of course, when we delve deeper into the history, we find that most of the European nations, including those in Southern Europe and Central Europe, were also involved in this. We are gathering information on the role of Switzerland. We are gathering information on Russia, wide, far beyond the normal parameter that we have expected. But at the moment, the principal nations identified are those six Western European nations.
And is there any concern on the part of any government officials here that if the reparations movement were to bear fruit, that that would impact aid for the governments and for the countries that exist already?
Now, the governments will have to speak to that themselves. The governments will be obviously in the best position when they are entering this dialogue with other governments, how they will craft that landscape. We are going to be sending forward recommendations. So again, it will be for the governments to know how best to craft their diplomacy and their other global engagements.
And I apologize, just one last question. And this is hopefully for Mr. Stein. Just wondering if the firm has contacted on any of the governments not on behalf of the governments of CARICOM necessarily, but just any engagement with any government representatives of France or of Britain or what have you.
I would invite Richard Stein of LIDE to make a comment on that.
Good morning. Thanks for hearing me here today. We haven't. Clearly, our role is very much to advise the CARICOM states, and matters will be conducted through their diplomatic channels we wouldn't take those kinds of direct steps ourselves.
Thank you. My name is Nora Wittmann, and I have two questions. One would be directed to the representative of LIDE. From what I, the information that I've had is that LIDE suggests that the claim should be based on the convention of convention on the eradication of all forms of racial discrimination, and I would like to know why. That is the case when international law, in fact, provides a sound legal basis for full and comprehensive reparations. Do you want to answer to that now, or as I state the second question
Richard,
right away?
Fine. Thanks. Well, obviously, this is a very complex and technical area, but unfortunately, we've advised the states that this is the most direct and effective basis for bringing these complaints to the states. If I can just explain, the first step would be, as Professor Beckles has said, attempts to resolve the matters listed in the statement that Professor Beckles gave, diplomatically, through dialogue and negotiation. And it's only if that is unsuccessful, then the issues that have been raised through the CERD Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Racial Discrimination would be the basis for forwarding that complaint to the slave-owning and trading states on the basis that slavery and native genocide are both forms of racism established by the United Nations that would need to be eradicated by signatory states, which all these states are under the convention. And in the event that the states aren't prepared to take adequate steps to do that, then a complaint will lie to the International Court of Justice for them to declare. And that is the advice that we've given, that that's the most effective way that the Caribbean states can pursue their claim legally if they're not able to succeed in the diplomatic dialogue, which is obviously the best way and the first step that would be taken.
And please bear in mind that the purpose of this commission is to receive advice and counsel and then to submit that advice and counsel and our reports to the heads of governments. The heads of governments may or may not accept the recommendations of our commission. So we are really here to, in a sense, initiate a process which will then garner ideas, information, which we will submit to the heads. And then, of course, it will be entirely up to the heads to decide what actions and the form of the actions that they will take. So we are really advisory, so to speak, to the heads.
All right, thank you. My concern was just that from what I conceive so far, the convention is more based on policy and development policy, when reparations and how it is grounded in international law is really gives a right to full and comprehensive massive reparations financially, historically, many satisfaction. There's so many things that can be based grounded in international law, and I just think that the CERD Convention might be weak. And but that is
well,
my
again,
assessment.
Please again bear in mind that we have available to us in the Caribbean a very mature and very sophisticated community of lawyers. Mr. Bert Samuels is here. Lord Anthony Gifford is one of us, and he has been in the forefront of this discussion for many, many years, and we are extremely honored to have him as well as Bert Samuels. So what we will be doing, we will be taking the finest legal briefs from Caribbean lawyers as well as from LIDE that has some experience in this matter. We will put all of this together and make the submissions to the heads. Many of the heads, as you know, are lawyers themselves. So they will be taking all of this, sifting through our recommendations, and they will decide on the path they will take and on the actions that they will take.
All right, thank you. And the next question that I have would be directed to the Minister Hanna. And I'm just wondering how the Jamaican government would want to raise support within the population. When I see that right now, the Jamaican government is still kind of violating the right to self-determination of African people through what is happening with Pinnacle, that Pinnacle is distracted and taken away from the Rastafari people, who have in fact been one of the most outspoken carrier of the reparation demand. And if that is going on, I'm just wondering how within the population support for reparations can be generated when that is happening at the same time.
Thank you for your question. As it relates to the Jamaican government, we have established a National Commission of Reparations, which has been doing its work diligently, and the report has been completed. That report is before me, and it will go before Cabinet, which will ultimately be discussed at another level and certainly hopefully get to Parliament for debate. The other issue as it relates to national dialogue is one that is being supported by the government of Jamaica, certainly by our Prime Minister. I know that she has spoken diligently and vocally at Caricom. Professor Beckles and others can attest to that. And she does support persons understanding the real issues behind reparations. Now, obviously, the Rastafari movement have been carrying an aspect of reparations, because reparations, the dialogue, is a very wide and all-encompassing matter. And one of the issues that the Rastafari movement have been carrying is under the umbrella of reparations. Pinnacle is a different discussion. That discussion has to do with heritage sites, and certainly at another time and at another event, we can have that discussion.
Lord Gifford wishes to
just a comment,
make a
if I may, on the legal issues which have been raised. My name is Anthony Gifford, and I've been a friend of and advocate for the cause of reparations for many years. I was recruited by another giant Jamaican advocate, Dudley Thompson, who I think will be very happy to see that the cause which he devoted much of his time to here and in Africa is now reaching a new stage of fulfillment. And I was committed to this because it seems to me that the transatlantic slave trade and the institution of slavery constituted the greatest injustices in human history. And no apology for it, no compensation for it, no reparation for it has ever been made. In fact, as you know, at the ending of slavery, it was the planters who got compensated for the loss of their so-called property. Nothing that, which perpetuated the inequality, which has reverberated and has its consequences to today. So I agree with Dr. Whitman, who asked the questions about the legal aspects, that the case for reparations is firmly based on sound international legal principles of repair being required when crimes against humanity have been committed, and repair includes appropriate reparation to those who still suffer the consequences of that crime. And I see the initiative under the CERN, the Convention Against Racial Discrimination, as a step along the road, but not the end of the road. I think we need a much more wide mobilization of Caribbean, African, and world opinion in due course. It'll take time. But I am happy to discuss all avenues which can bring the governments to the table. In relation to what the minister, I think he was the Minister for Foreign Affairs, said in Jamaica recently, that no reparation would be paid. My colleague Bert Samuels, I'm sure, will agree that he and my colleague Donna Parchman Brown, who is the great mediator, will agree that when you go into mediations and discussions to try to mediate a dispute, the powerful party against you often says, "We're not going to pay a penny." And they end up with skillful mediation and with firm, resolute position being taken by those who have been wronged. You end up with a settlement. So it is here. The fact that the government has said no doesn't worry me or concern me in the least. The cause is just, and I believe that it will triumph.
Yes, I would just probably like to add to that. My name is Robert Ras Caleb Gordon, founding member of the Rastafari Youth Initiative Council and director, and co-author of Little Athene and the Cause for Reparations. Seems to be the first children's book on slavery reparations, unfortunately. My concern is that my reparations consciousness is increasing, and I do have a concern, and my concern is that I know reparations, and I'm coming from a Rastafari perspective, to mean, you know, repair at many levels. So there will be many processes, you know, not only dealing with the socioeconomic, the political, the cultural, but the psychosocial, you know, the 500 years of fear, you know, that has gone into our gene and been passed on to our very offspring. And I want to know, how do you repair or compensate, you know, for that? And I would like anyone to answer that. Reparations, for me and for Rastafari, and coming from a Rastafari Youth Initiative Council's perspective, that reparation does not mean social reform, nor does it mean debt forgiveness. It means much more. It means a turning around, you know, in global power. You know, it means global survival. I'm of the view that the monies used in evil scientific Western experiments on food, you know, humans as guinea pigs, trips to the moon, research about Mars, it's all transatlantic slavery reparations monies. Monies used in nuclear warfare, energy, is reparations money. Money is being wasted, our wealth, you know, is being taken to do other things because the African people globally are not defending what is actually theirs. And I'm of the view also, maybe from the British firm directly, I'm also of the view that reparation is something that also may have to be taken. And what is meant by actually taking it is the constant, you know, protest.
Can we answer your question?
Okay, yeah, please.
Yes, so first of all, I wish to thank you for your statement, and we recognize the authenticity of what you have said, and we will certainly have those conversations at the national level, at the regional level, but at the moment, what we wish to do is to field questions from the media in respect of the statement which we have issued, or any other relevant question. Please.
Chairman and Minister, and ladies and gentlemen. I'm Alfred Sangster, the formerly of UTEC. I have three things to comment on. First, I think that as far as background, it's clear that the reparations issue is gaining ground and traction, certainly in the Caribbean. And secondly, the case for it is being made, and the case is well made in respect to financial, social, moral grounds. That's my first point. The second point I want to make is this, that there are rivers to cross. Here are three of them. First, the first rigor is those in the region who argue in cynical terms about the concept of reparation. Add to that the idea that reparations ought to blame the Africans as well, who were part of the slave system. The second river to cross is that certainly in the UK, there are groups and there are word back that the principle of reparation is rejected. Thirdly, there is what I call the Caricom weakness. Let's not fool ourselves. Right now there are issues about trade, there are issues about the role of Caricom and its strength and authority in world affairs and in the case and in the fight that is implicitly behind us or in front of us. So there are some rivers, and there are others, I suppose, as well. So my third point is this. Strategically, there should be, in my view, three basic directions to pursue. First, a direction in which the reparation principle should be developmental oriented. I've seen this, but it can be no less strategically identified that developmental issues which can be documented, which can be articulated, which can be measured, are critical in terms of achieving, in a sense, the traction that you're necessary for the support. It also has the possibility of bypassing handout concepts, where essentially who's going to get, etc. So development orientation is a basic principle. Secondly, the principle also is that it should be clearly non-political. I don't mean that we don't have political inputs to it, but it should not essentially be, in the long run, under the control of political parties, which eventually often are not necessary, which involve often bipartisan confusion. Thirdly, it should essentially have a principle of partnership involvement. By that I mean that there are people in the region who have benefited from the slave idea, the slave principle. And essentially, some of these can be identified, and they should, either voluntarily or in other ways, brought into a partnership where we see the whole principle going forward together. Thank you very much, Chairman.
Yes. Thank you, Mr. Sangster, for your comments. Any other questions from members of the media, please? Yes, please.
Media
questions? Please. Let's assume that we recognize it took 400 years to build the slavery system and a system of global trading in African bodies. Let's assume then it took us all of the 19th century to uproot it. Let's assume that between the Haitian Revolution, 1804, independence, the 1880s at the end of this journey in Brazil and Cuba, 100 years. Let's assume we are now at the beginning of the 21st century and we are seeking to repair the damage that has been done to the people of African descent and the indigenous population during that period. And let's assume that we are going to put all of our efforts and our energies and our finest thinking and our greatest compassion into achieving closure on all of this terrible history. We will be as successful as the people of the world wish us to be. But there is something called human agency, that you ought not to be deterred by the enormity of a challenge. You should begin. And what we have to commend the heads for doing on this occasion, they have said Caribbean peoples have been speaking of this matter for many, many decades, and the heads have taken a decision that they will now seek to facilitate that process. So the process will begin, and hopefully it will end sooner rather than later.
Yes. Just a little bit, similar to the same question, just trying to get a sense of the timeline. When do you think clients will actually be approached or engaged? Will that likely happen in 2014, or is the regional discussion something that may take years?
We are certainly hoping that by the end of our work as a commission, when we have submitted our best thoughts and the research that we have garnered to the heads, that they will look upon it favorably and they will make those decisions. I certainly hope that we can certainly influence them to do this work sooner rather than later. Any other comments from members of the media? If not, well, I thank you all so very much, all of you who are here, all of our guests on the internet. Thank you all very much, and in the spirit of our departed one, have a great day. Thank you. Lisa, thank you so much for coming. Thank you so much for coming. Full of surprises. Full of surprises.
Yeah, thank you.